In this video module of the Edgedetection walkthrough, we focus on making the design synthesizable as well as optimizing it to achieve our performance requirements. Although Catapult can synthesize the majority of the C++ language, there are some language constructs that are not supported, such as dynamic memory allocation. This is because we're building physical hardware and these hardware resources have to have a finite amount of storage. Pointers to arrays mapped to memories on the design interfaces are not supported. Arrays with constant bounds are needed instead. And lastly, float and double native types are also not directly supported, although Catapult does support AC float, B float 16, and IEEE float. In this example, some of our overall design goals consist of, we would like to achieve roughly 1 pixel per clock throughput on the interfaces. The image that we'll be processing is 1296 by 864 pixels, which means that we need to be able to process an image in roughly about 1 million clock cycles. It also means that we will be implementing a sliding window architecture and line buffer architectures to achieve this performance, as well as it will require multi-block concurrency. Streaming interfaces on the I/O will be required, and we also want to minimize the amount of on-chip memory storage. Some of the final steps will consist of architecting the hardware to use just single port memories, as well as optimizing for power, which will require using a circulating line buffer memory architecture. In this video module, though, we will focus on making the design synthesizable and optimizing that synthesizable model, as well as analyzing potential performance bottlenecks. Let's start by looking at the code changes we needed to make to the bit accurate version of the design from the last video module in order to make it synthesizable. We'll do this using the compare diff tool to look at the difference between the two files. So the first thing that we can see is that instead of using the native C math.h header file for doing things such as square root and arctangent, they were now including Catapult's math libraries for these particular implementations. So we're doing a pound include AC math slash AC underscore square root underscore PWL, where this is a piecewise linear implementation of a square root, which has good accuracy and area efficiency. And then AC underscore math slash AC ATAN2 cortic, where this is a cortic implementation of the arctangent. Scrolling down in the design, we can see some of the changes that were made to make it synthesizable. On the top level design interface, in the original and bit accurate versions, we were using pointers to represent the arrays in our test bench. We can see now that we've created bounded multidimensional arrays on our top level design interface in order for the tool to be able to synthesize these to memory interfaces. Next, we can see that we've taken the original internal storage, which was created using dynamic memory allocation, and we've converted that to use arrays with constant bounds. Internal to the design for the various functions, we can see now also that we're declaring our arrays with constant bounds, and we're operating on these multidimensional arrays in the vertical, horizontal, and magnitude and angle functions. And lastly, in the magnitude and angle calculation, which was doing the most computationally complex operations, such as square root and arctangent, we've converted that to use the Catapult AC math IP functions, AC square root PWL, which is a piecewise linear implementation of a square root, as well as the AC ATAN2 cortic implementation of the arctangent. Now that we've analyzed the code changes, let's go ahead and synthesize the design in the Catapult GUI. We do this by launching Catapult at the command line and providing it with the edgedetect underscore synthesizable.tickle file that will add the input files and set up some basic constraints. We can use the Catapult GUI to get an understanding about the constraints that have been set on the design, as well as we could also look at the tickle file itself. Looking at the hierarchy settings, the top level design has been set to our Edgedetect underscore synthesizable class, which I can cross probe to by double clicking. The technology is set to the Oasis RTL NAND gate 45 nanometer technology that ships with the Catapult tool. We've set a clock frequency of 300 megahertz. And then on the design interface, we can see that because we have large arrays over a million elements each, that they have been mapped to RAMs with one read port and one write port. And internal to the design, we have two quite large arrays of over a million elements each to store the computation of the X and Y derivatives. And again, double clicking within the GUI shows me where those objects came from within the C code. And then we can see we have a number of loops in our design that for the various functions. One thing to note here is that loop merging has been disabled in this example in order to simplify our analysis when we look at the scheduled design. Before we begin doing analysis and optimization, let's go ahead to see what kind of performance we're getting with the unoptimized design. The design is unoptimized because, as you can see, there are no loop constraints for unrolling or pipelining that has been applied to the loops in the design. The table view shows us that we're getting a latency of over 24 million clock cycles to execute this algorithm in hardware, and our ultimate goal is to be approximately a million clock cycles. So we need to do some analysis and optimization. The first place to start analyzing the design for performance bottlenecks is to look at the schedule view of the design. Expanding the main loop of the design, I can see the loops for the different functions in my design. When optimizing the design for performance, the first thing we want to do is to pinpoint the performance bottlenecks in the algorithm. Looking on the right side of the schedule view, we can see the runtime profile, where the large green bar indicates the total amount of runtime, and then the smaller green bars for each one of the subloops shows how much time is being spent within a given loop. Most of the time is being spent in the MRO loop, which is the loop that is responsible for doing the magnitude angle calculations. Within the subloops, the dark green bars indicate how much time is being spent within the subloops. So we've already identified that MRO loop is where most of the time is being spent. And then within the MRO loop, then we can see we have the mCall loop, where the dark green bar here indicates that almost half of the processing time is being spent there. And then scrolling down, we see that the majority of the time is being spent here in the loop, which is used to do the computation of the arctangent. So let's start optimizing our design. And let's start with the arctangent loop, since that's where most of the computation is occurring. So we go to the architectural constraints view, select the loop for the arctangent, and fully unroll it. There's no need to regenerate RTL. We can simply reschedule the design to look at the performance. By unrolling the arctangent loop, we cut the latency in almost half. Looking at the interior loops now, the execution time is split evenly between the three loops for the three different functions. Let's continue optimizing our magnitude angle function loops by adding pipelining on the mCall loop. We've managed to improve the latency again by reducing it by over 3 million cycles. The majority of the time is being spent calculating the vertical and horizontal derivatives. So let's go ahead and try pipelining those loops as well. We'll start with the vertical derivative loop, where we can see that V column is where the majority of the execution time is taking place. And we'll pipeline V column with an II of 1 and reschedule the design. The scheduler fails and gives us the following error: insufficient resources, on a memory, two are needed, but only one instance are available. And what this is telling us is that the memory that in, which I can double click and cross probe to, so this is an array on our top level design interface, that we are trying to read it two times, but there's only one read port available in the memory. This is a very typical scheduling failure when pipelining the design with bandwidth limiting resources such as memories or I/O. The scheduling error that we have encountered is also known as a memory resource conflict. Resource conflicts occur when trying to simultaneously read or write from a memory more times than there are read and write ports. When the design is pipelined, this will make the reads or writes overlap, generating the error. This can be easily understood by looking at an example. Looking at our vertical derivative example, we can see that the datin array, which is mapped to a single port memory, is read two times. Although there are three accesses to datin in the C code, kernel 1 is equal to 0, which means we only have reads on the multiplication of kernel 0 times datin and kernel 2 times datin. Looking at the approximate unpipelined schedule of the design, the first read of datin occurs in the first clock cycle, and the second read of datin occurs in the second clock cycle for an iteration of the V column loop. The next iteration then starts over, and what we can see here is that there are no overlaps of the reads for datin. Pipelining the design with an II of 1 means that while we are doing the second read from datin for the first loop iteration, we will begin doing the first read of datin for the second loop iteration. And thus, we are simultaneously trying to read two times from a memory with a single read port, and this generates a resource conflict. We can analyze this resource conflict by looking at the unpipelined schedule of the previous solution. If we expand the V column loop, which is causing our resource competition, we can see that there are two memory reads on data in. Another way to view this then is to view by component utilization that shows you for a given component in what C steps it is used. And so I can see then that I have a memory read on dat in on the edge of C2 and a memory read for dat in on the edge of C3. Trying to pipeline with an II of 1 would mean that I would be doing two simultaneous reads, which is not possible. So the best pipelining constraint that we can use in this case would be an II of 2. As a last step then, let's go ahead and pipeline the V column loop and the H column loop with an II of 2. We're now at about 5 million cycles of latency, which is 5x more than our performance goal. This is because there is no real memory architecture in this current design description. We need to add memory architecture if we want to achieve our performance goals. As a final check, we should verify that the C code changes we made to make the design synthesizable have not broken the algorithm. We can easily do this by running the C test bench directly in Catapult by opening the verification folder and double-clicking on the makefile under GCC. Just like before, this compiles and executes the original floating-point algorithm and compares it to our synthesizable implementation, although the magnitude error is slightly larger now due to the fact that we are using the Catapult IP for the piecewise linear square root implementation, it is still relatively small. We can also visually inspect the output of the synthesizable model to make sure that the edges are still being detected as expected. Just like before, the output image from the synthesizable model appears to be the same as the original floating point algorithm. This concludes the edge detection walkthrough example for making the C code synthesizable.